Good afternoon, good morning, or good evening, or good night, depending on where it is you're joining us out there in the world. Welcome to a brave new world. I am Drew Altdoerffer, product manager here at Phase 1. I am joined, as always, by Lau Nørgaard, our chief visionary officer here at Phase 1. Before we get too deep into this, let's just do a quick check on audio video. Everyone can see us. Everyone can hear us. Is that true? If not, give us a little message down there in the... We're good. We're good. Thank you to all those that participated in today's first survey. So as you may notice, Lau and I are at a socially safe distance of 1.5 meters, but we are at the Phase 1 headquarters here in beautiful Copenhagen, Denmark. I wish I could say it was
rainy
sunny.
Copenhagen?
Yeah, but it doesn't matter because everyone's stuck inside.
Yeah.
But we are, of course, fortunate enough to be in a society that's gotten a little more lax with our quarantine.
Yeah.
And so we are able to come to the office and work if we'd like to, which we do like to.
Mm-hmm.
But we do have to maintain a safe social distance. And we, of course, have our antiseptic. Should we ever touch the same thing. So I hope everyone out there is staying safe, staying sane, and is doing something constructive with the new time that we've all found on our hands. Lau and I travel quite a bit, and we spend a lot of time now in the office and taking care of paperwork,
yes.
The practical things.
Yeah, there are things we suddenly have time to get done, both those kinds of things we've been pushing,
sure,
but also actually the opportunity to dig a bit deeper in some of the more interesting task that we suddenly have time to do well now.
And one of those things is, of course, conversations with photographers, conversations with people in the industry, current customers, future customers, we hope. And that's really what today's focal point is about, having a conversation with you virtually on the other end and talking about some of the great things that we've done with the camera system, some of the things that if you haven't tried yet, you will get the opportunity, and really listening to your feedback. So that's what today's all about, is talking about dual exposure plus and dynamic range, but of course, putting out starting the conversation, putting it out there that we are open and ready for your feedback. And really, we've got plenty of time on our hands to take that feedback.
Yeah,
so we're looking forward to it. Also, before I hear it in the comments by anyone that knows me, yes, I know I need a haircut. We don't all have the luxury of Lau's hairstyle, but one day. That hasn't opened up yet in Denmark, but soon. So excuse my appearance, but we're here, and let's get into it. Any questions throughout the entire webinar, please feel free to chime in, reach out, and we'll try and clear anything up as we get into it. And then, of course, at the end, we've got 15 minutes dedicated to some Q&A. So prep your questions and reach out. I'm moderating it right here. So away we go. So we are these people.
Again,
Lau and me. And what we're going to talk about is kind of, hopefully, we'll approach this the right way, talking about the different ways that we approach development for the camera system. Lau, from the visionary perspective, the very engineering perspective, the deep nerdy perspective, and me from the photographic perspective. And what we want to talk about today, as advertised, is dynamic range and dual exposure plus.
Yep.
Dynamic range is a feature that we've been able to improve, a specification we've been able to improve using the tool of dual exposure plus. But as always, we need to start at the beginning.
Yeah.
So we'll start at the helicopter view and talk about the two camera systems that you see in front of us, the XF camera system and the XT camera system. And Lau, since that is on your socially safe distance part of the table,
yes.
Why don't you go ahead and tell us about the XF camera system, what it is in a nutshell.
I think I'll just quickly touch on the pleasure and opportunity of having two distinct camera systems. We are making these two in-house, and the wonderful thing about having two very different camera systems is that it's not about one is more than the other. It's that we can allow them to be different for different purposes, for different users, for different types of photography. The XF is a very modular, very configurable, very remote controllable workhorse camera. It fits very well into tethered studio workflows. You can do focus stacking, control your studio lights, all of these things that gives you extremely detailed control in professional photography, in areas of architecture, in product, beauty, many of these types of photography. This one is tailored specifically for that.
It's tailored specifically for general use.
Maybe that's something it's hard to be specific for, but
it does
many things well because it's so flexible and configurable.
Right. And we, of course, when we design features for it, when we think about the camera system, when we're engineering, you know, how is this new feature going to work in the XF versus how is it going to work in the XT, we really have to put on two different caps, right? So we put on the studio-based workflow when it comes to the XF. How will this be used, integrated, and tethered into Capture One? Yes. How will it be integrated into all the other studio environments that are necessary for business to move forward? It is big. It is heavy. But in a studio environment, those are things that you can manage, right? Yeah. Everyone's got a studio stand, a tripod, and that's really where our mindset is with that camera system. Then we have the XT.
The XT essentially is designed for anybody who wants that image quality and flexibility of the IQ4, which of course is the same in both of these. It's all of the imaging and image processing horsepower is there. Wants all of that image quality, but in a package specifically designed for landscape photography or field use, very much thought of as a landscape camera. It works very well also for architecture and other things. But this camera is designed to do specifically that thing with no compromises.
Right.
So this is the camera that is designed to fit in the backpack and go places.
Right. So we have one camera system in the XF that we think of as a general use tool. That is primarily going to be used in a studio. And then we have a very specific purpose-built camera system in the XT that we really think of as a landscape camera system. We're, of course, never going to stop anybody else from purchasing the XT that wants to take it and put it to another application. But just to give some background into how we're thinking of the development of these two camera systems.
Yeah.
Now, as Lau pointed out, the thing that these have in common is that they're both powered by the IQ4. And that IQ4 digital back, be it the IQ4 100, the IQ4 150 achromatic, or the IQ4 150, it holds the Infinity platform. And that's really what's powering these two camera systems. So anything that we do for this IQ4 digital back will improve this camera system as well as improve that camera system. And that's part of the beauty of having a modular system. We can develop for one specific component and it can have dual benefits on two different camera systems. So that brings us to this slide, which I basically already said in words, but visually we have the IQ4 100 trichromatic, the IQ4 150, and the IQ4 150 achromatic. So three flavors, three variations of the IQ4, all of them hold the Infinity platform.
Yes.
And so these are digital backs that look like previous generations of digital back, but of course everything inside of them is very, very different. The only similarity that we would have between an IQ4 100 trichromatic and an IQ3 100 trichromatic is the sensor.
Yeah.
Everything else is going to be different, right? So that's really the brains of the camera system, what we develop for. And that's really what this focal point is about, is developing one specific feature that lives in the Infinity platform that you can apply to the XT, the XF, or if you took that digital back and put it on whatever else your imagination allows, that would, of course, allow features that like Dual Exposure Plus. So Lau, if you would, we've mentioned the Infinity platform. Can you give us the Spark Notes version of what the Infinity platform is?
That essentially is everything that comes after the sensor. So it's all of what is essentially inside an IQ4. It's what controls the sensor, reads the data, processes the data, drives the UI, implements the features, has all the connectivity to the outside world. So it's the whole platform for turning a sensor into a camera.
Mm-hmm.
And when we designed the IQ4, we also in that process designed the Infinity platform and as a platform we could grow with.
Mm-hmm.
We've been working on one common platform for the IQ1, 2, and 3 series with various tweaks and updates over the years. We had the new 150 megapixel sensor coming. We wanted more power to handle that sensor. It's a much, much faster sensor with much faster interfaces. We needed to beef up the platform for that. But we didn't just want to add that 50% extra oomph to keep up with 50% more pixels. we wanted something that we could grow with for many years into the future. So instead of just adding a 50% bigger processor and 50% faster memory, we looked at how much can we squeeze into the box. And we essentially improved almost all major defining.
It's not a very big box.
No, it's almost exactly the same box, actually. but we essentially improved all the defining factors with about a factor of 10.
Right.
Which means that even with 50% more pixels, we will still have very significant headroom to implement new features that we could not have done in the previous generation things of X.
And that headroom that we've designed into the Infinity platform in the IQ4 is what allows us to continue to innovate and develop for the exact same product.
Yeah.
So this is coming up on its second year anniversary.
Yes.
And we've had 3 iterations of firmware that have had different levels of development for this, and mm-hmm. there's going to be many, many more. So that
yes.
10 times the amount of power as the previous generation, you know, we really learned from that previous generation that if we over-engineer it in the beginning, we're going to be able to sustain it for longer and
yeah.
really develop the core features and everything that, you know, we want and, of course, our customers want.
Mm.
So the Infinity platform does all the heavy lifting for the digital back.
Yeah.
It, of course, powers the sensor. But other than that, it's doing everything else, right?
Yes.
It's controlling the sensor, but it's controlling the data moving. It's controlling the
all
processing.
Of that. And a big part of that is what's called an FPGA. It essentially is a, it's not a processor. It's a field programmable gate array.
Mm-hmm.
It's a data moving processing monster that is completely field operatable.
Right.
Field programmable. So essentially, instead of having a fixed customized processing chip that once you've made it and put it in there, it has a fixed pipeline.
Mm-hmm.
We do this with an FPGA instead, which means that almost all aspects of the way data flows, of the way data is processed in the digital back, we can essentially completely change that with field upgrades, with firmware upgrades essentially that is loaded into any IQ4 in the field.
Right.
We could change the fundamental ways of how they move and process data.
So as we work down the explanation in this funnel, we have the 2 camera systems. They're both powered by IQ4s. Those IQ4s have the Infinity platform. That Infinity platform is very, very powerful and has a few key benefits. It's
mm-hmm.
network-based language, so it can integrate with everything. That makes our life easier.
Yeah.
It's 10 times more powerful, more RAM, more processing power, so we can do more stuff with it. But then how we program it to do those things specifically, that's where we have FPGAs. We have processors that we can, from a firmware update, tell the camera system to be something entirely new. So essentially, with the firmware update, we can tell the camera system to be something other than what it was first delivered as. You know, it can be a new camera with just a firmware update. Now, we haven't gone so far as to completely redesign it with a firmware update, but we have redesigned a lot of the ways that it thinks. The way that we do this, the language that we, the umbrella we put it under at phase one, is the phase one lab. And that phase one lab is really, it's our workshop, so that we can develop a product, develop a feature, develop a tool, not all the way, but to a degree where it's safe and usable and manageable and people can understand it. And then we introduce it into the IQ4. So that phase one lab is just a core element of the IQ4, just like the sensor and the screen and the buttons and the UI. The concept of the phase one lab is a playground where we can release products, tools, features, functions that aren't done yet, but we can put them out there to our customers or future customers so that we can understand, how does this work? How would you like it improved? How can we fit it into your specific workflow, and how can it benefit your specific discipline? So that phase one lab is where today's tool, the Dual Exposure Plus, lives.
Yeah.
And anybody that's used a IQ4 150, IQ4 100 trichromatic, in the last year,
mm-hmm.
Is probably familiar with the automatic frame averaging. So Lau, if you could
yes.
you please tell us what automatic frame averaging is, other than to say it's this?
It's this.
I said other than.
Automatic frame averaging is essentially a way of doing long exposures without ND filters,
mm-hmm.
and it's a way of getting virtually noiseless images out of a sensor.
Right.
What it does is that it continuously reads images out of the sensor. So it just captures images back to back, reads these images out, and adds them up in memory.
And then it reads them out
and adds them up.
And it reads them out
and adds them up. What this does is that adding all of these individual images up in memory ends up looking like one long exposure.
Right.
That's what gets you from individual shots, this at a 40th of a second, looking like this,
right,
to 2 minutes of continuously doing 1/40th of a second shot and adding them up.
Right.
If you only add a few shots up, they it could look like a sequence or some staggered sequence. Once you add enough of them up, especially of something that is kind of organic and cyclic as waves, you get this blurred look.
And adding a lot of them up becomes very, very easy. So yeah. A 2 minute exposure, a static single 2 minute exposure, you're going to wait for the data to collect over 2 minutes. You're probably going to have an ND filter on there, and it's going to be one set of data. Yes. That's one set of noise. When we do the automatic frame averaging, because of the way we've designed the FPGA for this tool, at a 1/40th of a second over 2 minutes, you can do the math, right? 40 frames equals 1 second. There's 120 seconds in 2 minutes. That's how many frames we're collecting when we're running the automatic frame averaging. That's a ton of data that's moving, and that's a lot of this. Yes. And so doing all that, collecting all that data, and then averaging it out so we have one single file. Well, we've averaged it out. All the moving parts, all the moving waves and water have turned the image into a very still, glassy image, which we would normally achieve with filters.
Yes.
So we get the same effect, but the benefits that we get all serve our top priorities. And our top priorities are, can you name one?
Image quality.
I'll name the other one. Image quality. And there's a third.
Image quality.
Image quality. Yeah. So image quality, those are the top three priorities that we have when we're developing anything for the camera system.
Yeah.
It is a no compromise development path.
So essentially, at the end of the day, what frame averaging does is that it gives us the opportunity to create these aesthetics of blurred water, silky skies, removing people, all of the aesthetics of long exposures without the hassle of long exposures.
And
without ND filters, without the challenges of getting the exposure right and the focus right for long exposures. So that's kind of on the aesthetics part of it, the workflow part, on the kind of the pure fundamental image quality part. What it also gives us is essentially the ability to take all the light coming into the camera over a very long time and get all of the image quality from all that light. Only a little bit of noise, because all the noise in that time would kind of average out.
Right.
So the ratio, you get more image quality and less noise.
So chasing that dream of improving image quality, if you use something like automatic frame averaging, you don't need to use ND filters.
Yeah.
So right away, that's a huge gain in image quality, because you don't have a piece of glass or a piece of plexi that could have flaws, scratches, what have you, in front of the glass. It doesn't matter how good your filter is. Putting that in front of the lens is, of course, going to deteriorate the light coming through and hitting the sensor.
Yeah.
So you don't have that. That improves image quality. Then, because we're averaging all of these small, short exposures, we only have the noise level that would be created from one exposure at a 40th. And we really are limiting that and averaging it out. So we're only getting very, very little noise over that two-minute exposure. If I was going to do one single two-minute exposure, I would have 2 minutes of good data and 2 minutes of noise. If I'm doing a two-minute frame averaging, well, I have 2 minutes of good average data, and then I have 1/40th of a second worth of noise that fits into that average.
Yeah, that's almost technically correct.
Yeah, and I, on this side of my socially safe table, I live on the almost technically correct.
Yeah.
And you are the sane one that is technically correct.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
But that's one. So we have image quality for removing the filters. We have image quality by, you know, just by advent of reducing the noise, averaging it out over time. And then the more light that we get, the more data we get, the better the image is going to be. So that's our 3 points right there. Image quality. We've gotten so much data, so much light that we get a better end result for the final image. So that's how we've used the Infinity platform on the IQ4 to change the FPGA to average out data over a matter of time and give you the best possible image quality. Now that does one thing very, very well. And if I want to do a long exposure, this is the perfect tool for that.
It is.
But I want to get similar benefits and I don't want to do a long exposure.
Yes.
And so that brings us to today's topic.
Dual Exposure Plus.
So Dual Exposure Plus is using a very similar approach to the problem, but it's using it in a very different way. So what Dual Exposure Plus is this. Mm-hmm. You can shoot that, but it looks like that, and everything's perfect. The end of webinar, everyone can go home, we're good, finished ahead, no. Yeah. So Dual Exposure Plus is, of course, going to be similar to frame averaging in that it's going to use the FPGA. It's also going to use the 150 sensor, CMOS sensor. Mm-hmm. And what it's going to do is take two images almost at the same time. Do you want to go on the technically correct side of this while I stay on the almost technically?
I think almost at the same time is technically correct.
Okay, so almost at the same time. Okay. So taking one exposure that I dial in with the camera, I expose for my highlights, expose to the right, ETTR, yeah. Make sure that I'm going to maximize all the data, all the light possible without clipping in this particular image I was shooting directly into the sun.
And one consequence of doing that, of without clipping, because that's quite important. Once you clip, it's gone.
Right.
So in an image like this, where you're shooting straight into the sun without clipping, means that you actually have to dial the exposure quite far back.
Certainly.
So some areas in this image will be in very, very deep shadow.
And anybody that sees this sunny blue sky and very few clouds knows that the sunny 16 rule would apply perfectly without a meter to understand what a good exposure would be, right? And this is far, far below sunny 16. So really, this is what I'm forced to capture, right? The digital technology, digital photography forces my hand to capture this image.
Because the specific scene has a very, very high dynamic range, because you have almost have the sun, mm-hmm. back at clouds there, and you have the deep shadow in here.
Right.
So if you want to really make an image out of this,
I'm going to have to do some post-processing.
Yes.
So if I'm going to have to do some post-processing, this is typically what I'm going to do. So these are the same images that you had before. This is the shot at ISO 50, 140, 400th of a second, and F8 over here on Lau's side of the screen. And then on my side of the screen, we have ISO 50, 1/400th of a second, and F8, but in dual exposure mode.
Yeah.
Now, I've done two changes to these in Capture One, in my post-processing. The first thing I've done is I've reduced all the noise reduction. I've removed it so that we can actually look at the problem areas.
So that's not something you would actually do?
No.
It's essentially to be able to show the effect more clearly through webinar technology.
Right. Yeah. Webinar technology. I like that. The other thing I've done is I've cracked open the new high dynamic range tool in Capture 120. Fantastic tool. Mm-hmm. Well done, engineers. And I've just brought up my shadows. Not all the way, not to the max, but I've dumped my highlights down so I can recover those as much as possible. And I've cranked up my shadows. So both of these images have the exact same treatment. And both of those images, even now on this screen and perhaps you at home, you can see a slight difference in those images. Mm. So what is the root cause of that slight difference? It's noise. So with Dual Exposure Plus, with the seamless, almost instantaneous integration of two separate exposures, I get one raw file that gets all the benefits of my highlight capture, my ETTR, where I've exposed to the right and never clipped a single highlight. But then I get all of the benefits of a three-stop lower exposure to really expose for the shadows.
Yeah.
So where a single capture would give me 15 stops of dynamic range in a single capture, I expose to the right and I have to pull up the shadows. A Dual Exposure Plus capture gives me essentially, almost, mm-hmm. technically correct, 18 stops of dynamic range.
And what we see here is that in this ISO 50 shot, that by all means is not a bad shot.
No.
This level of noise in such a deep shadow pulled so far up, mm-hmm. it's still very impressive. And what we see here is that there definitely is noise here. It might be manageable with noise suppression, but we clearly see it. And there could be real world scenarios where you would have even more, and printing, making a big print out of this might be kind of on the edge of something you want to do.
Certainly.
On the other hand, if you look at the dual exposure shot over here, once you start bringing those shadows up and looking deep into them, it will essentially get these pixels from that longer second exposure.
The exposure that we did for the shadows.
So we have all the highlights safely from the metered exposure we did to the right.
Mm-hmm.
And any deep shadow areas, they will just be pulled out from that second exposure that is essentially exposed to the shadows. So once we dig into the shadows here, we don't see that noise.
Well put. So, you know, the practical applications of this, if we take this specific image as an example, I have to expose to the right. In traditional photography, if I didn't have this tool, this is really what I would be stuck with. If I wanted to, I could put a grad neutral density filter on this image, right? Mm-hmm. And that gradient neutral density would come down here and cut the top of the building off, so the top of the building would now be underexposed. It's not a perfect solution. Mm. So my alternative, if this is what I have, is really to deal with the single exposure, or I can do HDR bracketing.
And HDR bracketing essentially is also capturing multiple exposures at different exposure, multiple images at different exposure settings.
Right. So if we look at what dynamic range is and what an HDR post application is going to do.
Yeah.
Talk to us, Lau, about what dynamic range is, so we can all be speaking the same language.
Well, dynamic range technically is the range between the brightest parts of the image that has details and the darkest part of the image that has details. So in a shot like this, this is an example of traveling. This is literally 90 seconds walk from my front door.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very close range traveling that has been possible over the past week.
Following the guidelines, well done.
Yes. So the brightest area here might be this sunlit white wall here, areas in there. So I have to make sure that my exposure doesn't clip, so it has details there. So that would be the very high end of the dynamic range. And then I have to find the darkest areas I can find in the image, maybe inside that window frame or somewhere behind that tree, and look for the darkest areas where I can see details essentially in that murky, noisy area.
Right.
And then the range in stops between the darkest part and the brightest part, that is by definition the dynamic range of the image.
And the dynamic range, the higher the number, the better it is, the more that's there. Yeah. But of course, there's scenarios where you don't need all the dynamic range in the world, right?
Yeah.
And what are those scenarios?
Essentially, anything where you have control over the light.
Right. Full control.
Full control.
Right.
Studio work with simple objects.
Mm-hmm.
You can typically control the light. You can put a little bit more light into the shadows. You can control that. Of course, if you work with shiny things, it might be really difficult.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, if you have control over the light, or you are maybe outdoors on an overcast day,
right,
you can also get
very flat light. Right.
Then the difference between the brightest and the darkest areas are not that big.
So when dynamic range might not be super important is when there's not a big expanse and difference between my highlight and my shadow. That's pretty uncommon out in landscape photography.
Well, the sun is a really, really bright light source.
Yeah, it's true.
And anywhere where the sun doesn't hit the whole scene, mm-hmm. meaning shadows, there will be a very big difference.
Right.
In many cases, it's manageable. But once you start working with your files in post-production, pulling up shadow areas, creating the final look you want, you will be massaging that data and pulling things up. And that's where you get into maybe not necessarily the limitation, the kind of the true technical limit of the dynamic range.
Right.
But even within the dynamic range, you will be pulling up shadow areas that are actually very underexposed.
Mm-hmm.
So once you pull them up, they will essentially look like underexposed or
super high
ISO. Super high ISO. It's actually...
Because I'm taking that little noise that exists and I'm amplifying it by adjusting it.
So it's the same phenomenon that makes high ISO images look noisy, is that it only has a little bit of light to work with.
Mm-hmm.
It's essentially deeply underexposed, but you want it to look bright.
Yep.
So that is the case we have here, that if I have a well-exposed image,
right,
then I have all the blue here. That is my actual image data. That's the light.
It's a good stuff.
The good light I want to capture. And if I expose it well, I will have a certain amount of light and some noise. Inherently, in capturing light, there is some noise. But if I have a lot of light, I have mostly good stuff.
Right.
And then when I make my image in post-production, I don't have to amplify or do anything. So I just have the same relationship between image and noise.
So let's say that was a well-lit shot. With dynamic range that doesn't exceed what it is the camera can provide. You don't need any more.
Or maybe even more precisely, it's a well-lit part of a well-lit shot.
Sure.
There I will get this.
Because I don't need to massage any of that data.
Now over here, I have something that is very underexposed.
Mm-hmm.
Deeply, deeply underexposed. So this could either be shot in the dark, an actual underexposed image, high ISO or something, or it could just be a shadow area.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe my image is well exposed, but there's a certain area of it that is very dark,
right,
which will happen in the shadow. If I then want to make this look brighter, I have to gain this.
The whole thing.
There's not that much noise here, but there's very, very little image.
But I'm amplifying it.
So I want more image. I also expand, also amplify, and I get more noise.
Right.
It's exactly like if you're recording with a microphone or a tape recorder, and you don't put up, if you put the recording volume too low, you have a very little bit of sound. When you then amplify it, you amplify both the sound and the noise, and you get it. It's the same thing. So essentially, the more light we capture, the less noise we have. So we always want to fill all our pixels with as much light as possible.
Right.
And that's normally difficult to do in the shadows.
Sure.
Because if we want to do that in the shadows, then we have the other problem over here where we overexpose the highlights. And there it's even worse. Because if you start out with a pixel that has seen too much light, it's clipped. Once it has counted to the most number of photons it can see, it just stops. Which means that all of your pixels in the highlight will just have the same maximum value. They will, of course, look white. But if you then start to pull them back in post-production, you can just make them uniform gray.
Right.
There's no detail to be got there. So if I have this clipped one,
we're all
and
familiar
I
with
scale
that.
It down, it just becomes flat.
Yep.
So therefore, carefully exposing to the right and never too far to the right, you have to do that for the highlights, meaning that all of your shadows, they're deeply underexposed.
And that's when this could be maybe not the whole image, but a part of the image is what you're going to amplify.
Yes. And as long as you keep them as dark shadows, it's not a problem because there is almost nothing there. It just looks black. When you bring it up, you have almost no image data and some noise. So to boost that data, you also boost the noise.
Good explanation. So
yeah,
the ways that we can avoid this traditionally have been HDR bracketing in post.
And that's HDR bracketing is very simply put, shooting one exposure for the highlights and another exposure for the shadows, or shooting multiple exposures that are exposed differently, and then bringing all of them into your software, processing them out, combining them in Photoshop or other tools, which means that essentially for every single pixel, you can go and pick the value from an optimally exposed frame.
Right. And I mean, this we have the example here with two images, but this could be 2, 4, 8. This could be 100 images, and the dynamic range that you could create could essentially just be
a gray image.
Yes. It could just be infinite dynamic range.
Yes.
But this is the way that we would traditionally tackle this: is by taking one image and then a second image, which can happen very seamlessly, very quickly.
The camera actually has full automation of that with many shots. It works very well as long as nothing moves.
And it works well on the capture end, but on the post-processing end, it is many, many, many extra steps.
You have to see that as individual images that you then process and combine.
Yes.
And if there's any movement, then you have to make either use software that will kind of guess, or you have to do manual masking. It works. You can make beautiful images.
Absolutely. And people have forever. But there's a convenience factor. Yeah. That we're missing, and there's a detriment to image quality when you're having to edit images individually, combine them individually, then start to move and change.
And there are specific shooting scenarios where it's really difficult, like moving water, leaves in the wind, birds, things moving.
So this can work. It will still work. It works today. It'll work tomorrow. It'll work well into the future. But then we get into the dual exposure plus feature itself. And how it is we've taken the concept of HDR, but we've really turned it on its ear and changed it into a completely integrated tool within the camera system.
So instead of having a fully flexible capture end tool that allows you to capture any sequence of any exposures as we have in the XF, we've made a much simpler tool. It's only two images, but they're captured, I think the technical term is, almost at the same time.
Almost.
So essentially, they're captured completely back to back. It's actually starting the second exposure before it's done reading the first
and
one out.
And that's what we mean by almost at the same time.
So doing this, it's actually a feature built into the sensor device itself driving this. So it can be that close back to back. So instead of having, getting back to this, one image where the brightest areas are exposed to be just at the edge of clipping, and the darkest areas will therefore be almost down here in the noise area with very, very little light. We now automatically, almost at the same time, capture two individual images. One that is well exposed, that you expose for in the camera, you use the clipping warning and everything to make sure it's well exposed. And then the IQ4 automatically captures a second exposure that is three stops more exposed, to make sure that there is data for the shadow area.
So it's three stops slower, adjusting the shutter speed.
And these two sensor captures are read out and are combined into one single RAW file that is stored as one file on the card. When that is then read into Capture One, you see it as just one RAW file, and you can use the normal Capture One tools to tweak that and edit it to your heart's desire.
And so when we look at the end result of a single capture, we have a single capture with 15 stops of dynamic range. That's using the IQ4's IIQ large 16-bit extended mode.
Yes.
It's a mouthful, but that's the type of file that it's going to create, is a 16-bit RAW file, and that's what's going to give me the 15 stops of dynamic range.
Yeah.
It's a bit slower of a capture process. It slows the camera down. Mm-hmm. It measures the data a little bit slower, but it gives me that one single capture with 15 stops of dynamic range.
Yeah.
Now, if I go into Dual Exposure Plus and I capture the exact same file format, but using this tool, using the sensor in this unique way, using the FPGA to kind of combine all that data, what I end up with is still one single RAW file that exists on the card, that exists in the camera, that at a glance looks the exact same as a single
capture. It looks the same. There's no HDR look to this.
No.
It looks exactly the same, but once I start pulling it in post, all of the dark areas in this one will now come from a correctly exposed shot.
Right.
And all of the bright areas will come from another correctly exposed shot for those areas individually.
So where one is going to be 15 stops of dynamic range in a single capture, we can call Dual Exposure Plus a single capture, because that's what I end up with, is one single file. But now I'm working within the realm of 18 stops of dynamic range, which is a huge jump. If you know even a little bit about dynamic range, if we get a half a stop out of it, we're very excited. So it's a huge jump.
Yeah.
To move from 15 stops to about 18 stops.
Yeah.
So now if we just touch back on, you know, kind of the how it works, it is doing those two exposures at almost the same time. Before the first exposure, which I dial in, I chose, I'm exposing to the right. Before that exposure is finished, the second one already begins. So they kind of chase each other in the lines of the CMOS sensor so that they can be processed out faster and so that there isn't that big gap that would happen with post-process stacked HDR images, where there's one capture and then another capture. These are happening almost simultaneously. The file is the same as far as Capture One's concerned. It looks like an IIQ RAW file. I don't see any difference. The metadata tells me that it's different. It's when I start to move the file and change it and manipulate it that I really see the main benefits.
Yeah.
And then the size of the file, it's two files that are combined, so it's going to be slightly larger, but it also depends on the content of what I captured.
Yeah.
And the speed, of course, is the same. It's imperceptible that you're using Dual Exposure Plus mode as opposed to a single capture. The only difference is the difference in the shutter speeds of that process. So that's what Dual Exposure Plus is. That's how it works. The benefits, again, if we go back to what we originally talked about as our priorities, are image quality, and image quality. So we use the example of frame averaging and how frame averaging can improve image quality by removing the filter, by getting a ton of data, and the more data you have, the better the image quality is going to be, and of course reducing the noise over averaging all this data together. Well, we get some of the same benefits with Dual Exposure Plus. Remember, the base noise level that we're going to capture is going to be the same, but it's going to be a combination of two exposures. So what noise level, where noise would appear in the shadows of my ETTR, my highlight exposed image, it's going to be three stops lower for the shadow one. So once I have that image and I start pulling it up, well, I'm going to be have a lot more flexibility within Capture One. So that's the other image quality improvement. And then, as I mentioned, you wouldn't need to use filters in this scenario either. You might have ND grad filters that might cut off a building. So you have some more flexibility. And when we look at the actual images, this is a normal exposure inside of a very beautiful school here in Denmark. This is at a higher ISO, ISO 200, 500th of a second. and I've recovered the shadows. So this is something I would do in post so I could see all the beautiful woodwork, right? I want to expose for the light coming through the windows, but I really want to bring up all the beautiful detail in the woodwork inside, in the shadow areas. I'm going to bring up a lot of the noise with it. And by using Dual Exposure Plus and taking the exact same image, went too far. I do the exact same application, right? So it's the exact same shot with the exact same exposure, but one's using Dual Exposure Plus, the other one is not. When I bring up those shadows in post, they're noise free. So that's the difference between having to do an HDR separate image stack and then seaming them together in post-production versus using this tool once and then changing the shadow or recovery in Capture One and getting all that detail. So that's Dual Exposure Plus in a nutshell. So if there's any questions about how it works, the method behind it, why we would use it, what the limitations are, please ask. I'll start fielding those while Lau talks more about the images that I'll bring up on screen.
Yeah.
And keep in mind that Dual Exposure Plus, it is a new feature in the IQ4, but it is still within our lab workspace. So that phase one lab, again, just as a reminder, is where we put the beta features. That means that this tool is not done. That doesn't mean that you're not going to get great results, that it's not ready for professional applications. It absolutely is, but we haven't finished up the UI implementation, where it's accessible on the camera, how you're going to be able to use it, when maybe the camera automatically detects and suggests that it kicks on. There's a lot of nuance in how we can implement it into the camera that we are eagerly awaiting the feedback of you, the customers, so that we can finish this up, put it into the camera system, and really clean up the feature.
I think that's maybe the main purpose of this whole lab concept is that when we've made a technology component, we see a lot of potential in the technology behind the Dual Exposure Plus. We've been doing test images with it. We've implemented the under the hood machine itself. We've made a user interface to be able to do that. Now we would very much like to open it up to all of you to get feedback to how best turn this still maybe a little bit geeky, but very interesting technology component into an intuitive, useful photographic tool, essentially, to get the workflow, the usability, to get all of these things right. And there we really need your input, and we want to invite you in to be part of that process.
And, you know, trust me, Lau and I have nothing but time on our hands sitting behind our computers having conversations just like this, but on a one-on-one basis with photographers just before the webinar. We had a very long one.
Yes.
You know, that's what we're doing now. So we welcome any opportunity to talk more about this feature or other features with the camera system with you, our customers.
Yes.
So thank you for stalling for time. Now we have these two images up.
Yes.
These are the images that I showed as examples in the webinar. So what I've just done, this image over here on the left, my right, your left. This one is a normal exposure. And then right behind it, number 07 versus 06. 07 is shot with Dual Exposure Plus. This is the default view in Capture One. So when you take these images into Capture One, this is exactly what you see. And at a glance, on the surface, these images are the exact same. There is nothing special about one over the other. It just looks like they're a sequence. Now, I've turned off noise reduction on both of these images just to accentuate the benefits here. But if we go over to our wonderful high dynamic range tool, and all we want to do is bring up our shadows, and we can really crank them up to 100%, and we'll bring up our black point, really bring it up to 100%, and apply that exact same adjustment to this image, 07. If we zoom in...
This, of course, is a very extreme edit.
Sure.
So
some people might like it. If we zoom in 100%, and remove this tool, we can see that the images are sharp, but the image on your left, my right, you can see the noise in the deep, deep shadow of that window. Now, that noise is certainly, it's not problematic. I've really cranked up the shadows, and of course, remember, I've turned off the noise reduction. So at a base ISO, this is not really a problem. But it illustrates the difference very, very well.
In that even with one of the best image sensors in the world, you will see, you will hit this limitation of noise in the shadows. It's fundamental physics and math. So maybe even zoom further in just to make it even more clear what's actually happening there.
Dun dun dun. I'm doing this over my shoulder.
So once you actually now we are at 300%, and here you can see that in the left on the left side in 06, the single shot image. At this level of zoom, the noise almost takes over and you cannot see the fine detail.
Mm-hmm.
On the right hand side in 07, you see detail, even in the stones and
in the mason's tool.
Yes.
That was crafting that piece of stone, I don't know, 100 years ago, where I don't know how old that building is. But you can still see that detail where the noise is what's obstructing it from the normal shot. Now, if we take that exact same concept of where is the real world practical application for this, at fit to view, where the images are being downsampled, even now, if you look closely, you can see a difference. And that difference is really in the texture and the density of the grass. So on the image that is a straight shot versus the image that is the dual exposure plus, I have much more clarity and contrast in the grass in my foreground. And if we zoom in 100% or beyond to 100% and beyond, we can really start to see how that fine detail with this high resolution sensor, that fine detail of the grass is, of course, picked up. But when I pull up the shadows, my noise is interrupting that fine detail of the grass. So when I pull up the shadows on a big swatch of grass like that, all of a sudden my density starts to get lost because noise takes over.
What we see when we zoom in here is that these images are optically equally sharp.
Yes.
But on the left side, because in this shadow that has been pulled up, there is more noise, that noise essentially is random differences from pixel to pixel. And that actually becomes very visible when we look at something that is about a pixel big, where on the right hand side we have none of that noise. So even details down to the pixel level will be there very clearly by themselves.
And again, you know, at a glance with these images in Capture One, the native images coming in, I'm not going to see a difference. So if I reset both of these images, this is what I see when I shot it. I would have, unless I knew that I used the tool, and I can, of course, always tell that I used the tool thanks to metadata. I know that I've used Dual Exposure Plus on this image, and I know that I now have more flexibility, that the tools in Capture One that go to 100, it means 100 for this image, but it means 100 plus for this image. So that ability, that flexibility is a huge, huge benefit just in your post-processing. And keep in mind, if we were going to do this and achieve the exact same dynamic range and the exact same look and the exact same benefits with bracketing, with HDR bracketing, well, that would be two separate shots I have to edit independently. That's two shots that I have to output. That's two shots I have to put into Photoshop or some other software. I have to seam them together, and then I have to go hunt for the errors. This has all happened seamlessly in the iQ4 on the Infinity platform to give me one file with a huge gain in dynamic range that I can then reap all the benefits from in a software like Capture One. Let's find another good example. Yep. Let's go to the water.
Yeah, because what about movement?
That's a good question.
Because that's one of the real difficulties of traditional bracketing-based HDR.
So if we look at this image, this again, ETTR, exposed to the right, this image was shot to expose correctly for the clouds.
Here they are swapped. So the one that is on the left side, closest to me, is the dual exposure plus. And the one on Drew's side is now a single shot.
But you can see that the sequence of these images followed one another, right? That first I shot the image with dual exposure plus, the clouds drifted, and then I shot the normal exposure. So in a traditional sense, if I was going to do an HDR stack, I would have to jaggedly cut out that building and these trees because my sky has moved. Now with Dual Exposure Plus, I don't need to do any of that post-processing. I just have the flexibility of the one file. So let's take a look at that shadow recovery. So if we take the normal exposure and the Dual Exposure Plus, this building, it's a big dark black building. It's a bright sunny Danish day, rare, of course. But if I want to pull up all the shadows so that I can actually see the structure of this building, that's a big, dark, black monolith. And if I'm going to pull up those shadows as much as I need to so that I can see the detail, see the door, see the brickwork, the dual exposure plus is going to give me, again, with noise reduction removed, a very, very clean image. That 72 on the door, it's very legible, nice and crisp. I could print this without any problem. The reflection in the window, a touch of noise, but I mean, there's really nothing there. If I look at the single exposure with 15 stops of dynamic range, pulling it up, the shadows up exactly the same way, I have unusable noise in that window.
Yeah.
I've lost all that detail and structure to the brick. The jaggedness of the door number there is very, very visible. So these are all things that come with that single file, bringing up all the problems.
Even I would say color fidelity.
Sure.
Because once you're all the way down there in the noise, reconstructing the color of an area also becomes really difficult.
And so again, just for reference, the over-the-shoulder selection. Yep. Oh no, I zoomed in. This is how much I've pulled the images up. And again, I've done the exact same adjustment to the images. So this is the exact same exposure that was captured, the exact same adjustments to pull it up. And even again, at a glance, zoom to fit, you can see a distinct density difference in the shadow recovery. Because this one, I've brought up all the noise and all the problems. I've amplified them. And in this one, they don't exist when I amplify.
What about the water or maybe that buoy? Moving in the
Well, I'm glad you asked, Lau. Let me get rid of these guys. So if we look at... No, don't do that. Okay, I'm going to get it. I'm going to get it.
Okay,
holding the wrong button. Got it, nailed it. So if we look at the buoy, right? Something that is obviously going to be moving, bobbing up and down in the water. Now, if I did... HDR bracket with this specific scene, by the time I captured one image and I got to the next image, this buoy would have bobbed back and forth. So I would have to choose from one of the files which one I want to put in there and have to gently paint it in Photoshop or whatever software you want to use. I'm not biased. But using Dual Exposure Plus, there's moving objects like the buoy, there's moving waves, but it's happening so seamlessly. Those two captures right on top of each other. One starts before the other one ends. It's able to capture all that data so that I see no errors. I see no movement. I see no strange artifacts within the actual file. And that buoy and the moving waves is a perfect example. Now, we are using the electronic shutter when we use Dual Exposure Plus.
So they are only captured almost at the same time, there will be a limit. I think maybe the simplest way to phrase that is that there is the metered exposure that we or you select, and then there's just the second one that the camera will automatically calculate. Mm-hmm. It is three stops slower. So if that one, if you can live with the motion blur in that one, it will all be fine.
Right. And, you know, at a 500th of a second, three stops slower, I'm still within freezing.
They will still both be sharp, and they will merge perfectly.
And that brings up a very good point, Lau, that the camera is automatically choosing this second exposure, your shadow exposure. It's automatically choosing that shot, that exposure that's three stops less. Sometimes it's going to be exactly three, sometimes it's going to be a little different, but it's automatically doing the math, knowing how it's going to have to combine them, how it's going to have to run the sensor. So it's not something you get to choose. You unfortunately can't get one exposure at normal exposure and the next one 10 stops under. It does have to do with how we run the sensor, how we power the camera system. So it is automatically going to choose it.
Yes.
And that's the images. That's how it works. That's how Lau and I think about the camera systems and the lab and Dual Exposure Plus and the benefits. And now there's a lot of questions.
But that's...
It could be good. It could mean that we answered nothing.
Yeah.
So it could be bad.
Or we are difficult to understand.
But you have an accent.
I have a Danish accent. No, okay.
I don't.
But on a serious note, a big part for us about doing these webinars is, of course, to take questions. Drew and I, we both travel, or we used to travel quite a bit, and do events, and we love to meet all of you guys.
photographers from all over the world and talk about cameras and talk about photography and get to know what you like, what you don't like, how we can improve. And now that we're not traveling, we can't do that, physically at least, but we can do that in a different way by engaging with the community online. And that I think is for me at least a very big part of the joy of making cameras is getting all the reactions to the questions.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of questions here about unrelated things. Mm-hmm. So I'm not ignoring you, but I will get back to you after the webinar. There's a lot of questions about these sample files. They're all going to be available after the webinar, so you can download the raws, play with them yourself. No problem. A few good questions for you, Lau. Mm-hmm. Is it possible to reverse this process? Get two separate files from a single file in Capture One or some other magical software?
Yeah, so if you did capture a dual exposure plus file and then afterwards wanted for some reason to separate them out and do use a different workflow.
Mm-hmm.
It's not something that we have done or are necessarily planning to do.
Mm-hmm.
Technically, it's doable.
Right.
All the data is in the file to do that. But it's not something that we immediately plan to do.
So the answer is no.
The answer is no.
Okay. The benefits of Dual Exposure Plus, are they more evident at higher ISOs?
I would say that at a higher ISO, once you start pulling a file, you will much quicker get to the point of noise in the shadows.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, doing a second longer exposure, of course, will be even more beneficial there. But I would then also say that you could just as well start out with that second longer exposure.
True. Because I think a very good way to think about the image quality that you're going to get when you're preconceiving using this tool is you are going to get the noise from the underexposed image, right? So if you're shooting at ISO, 2000, well, you're still going to get ISO 2000 noise, but at a lower underexposed image. So you'll just get to it at a different time.
You could also say that if you crank up the ISO,
mm-hmm.
To freeze the motion, that would, if you're on a tripod, everything is still, you wouldn't need a high ISO.
Mm-hmm.
So if you go up in ISO to freeze some motion, and then you tell the camera to do a second exposure that's three stops longer, you could have not cranked up the ISO in the first place and just done that shot so every pixel was three stops better.
Sure.
So in that way, you would see it, but it would have been better just to start out with an exposure that was at three stops low ISO.
Right. I think I got it.
Yeah.
I was half listening and half reading, but I think I'm there. Is there limitations in exposure, Dual Exposure Plus? Yeah, it's a very general question, but there are limitations, certainly. And again, I'll reiterate that Dual Exposure Plus exists under the lab, which means from our perspective, it's not finished.
No.
So it is a tool that we've introduced for everyone to enable, to play with, to give us the feedback. Mm-hmm. That's why we've put it out there, so we can hear from you and hear your thoughts and hear your concerns, hear your fantastic ideas. So it's not done yet, and there are going to be limitations. There are shutter speed limitations. How long the exposure can go. Mm-hmm. If you're looking at exposures more than a second or 2 seconds, you might be better poised to use something like automated frame averaging rather than Dual Exposure Plus.
There are also essentially well-known bugs in it at the moment.
Sure.
It doesn't work with automatic white balance.
Right.
There are things like that where we know that, but we just wanted to get it out there, get your feedback while we are still working on the under-the-hood engine of it.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that we don't already want to have usability feedback, feature design feedback. And there are also some of the underlying mechanisms that we are still thinking about. Could we expand them in various ways? So absolutely, it will be a growing feature for a while.
And that's the way we want it to be.
Yeah.
That's the whole design of the lab, is these features and tools aren't done, but we already have some fantastic achievements that are you can get by using the tools, and it's only going to get better. So your ideas, your feedback is absolutely critical to make sure that we get this tool to where it needs to be. Is our dual exposure plus images compatible with all versions of Capture One? Excellent question. The answer is no. You need to use the version of Capture One, which I unfortunately do not know off the top of my mind, but it did come out at the same time as dual exposure plus in February. So it is 20.13.
Always use the newest version of Capture One.
Yeah, always use the newest. But it is, you know, it is seamless in Capture One, but Capture One still needs to know to identify the file to apply certain rules and regulations to it. So that is a good question. Make sure you're using the latest version so you can actually utilize this tool. Can you apply an LCC when using Dual Exposure Plus? Absolutely. Yeah. No problem there. An LCC, for anyone that doesn't know, is a lens cast calibration. It's something you would use in Capture One as well as capture a specific file for it so that you can remove any lens cast, and no problem using that with Dual Exposure Plus. Is the main benefit of Dual Exposure Plus noise reduction? It's one of them. It's not the main benefit. The real main benefit is going to be your post-processing flexibility, right? It is 18 stops of dynamic range as opposed to 15 stops of dynamic range. That's your main benefit. So if you could take a single shot with 18 stops of dynamic range, no one would hesitate to do that, right? Mm-hmm. So in the scenarios where Dual Exposure Plus makes sense, where you need it, where you want it, where it's not going to cause any problems with, you know, movement or the limitations of shutter speed, by all means, use it.
Yeah.
And then you have more flexibility in Capture One. This isn't a silver bullet. This isn't a miracle cure. If you clip your image, this will not have any effect or benefit in recovering those highlights that are lost. If you severely underexpose an image, this will help a little bit, but you know, really it's not going to be a huge benefit. But if you expose correctly, the net result, the file you're working with, has a tremendous dynamic range for post-processing, as opposed to the certainly fine, certainly fantastic dynamic range that exists in a single file.
I think putting all that those words into a very simple conclusion is that—
Please do.
The main benefit, I would say, is significantly increased shadow image quality.
Mm-hmm.
If you never, ever, ever want to pull up any shadows and accept that they are just as black as shot, it might not give you that much. But in all the cases where you need to bring in shadow details, Dual Exposure Plus gives you almost automatically much cleaner shadows.
And that's really where you're going to be able to see.
That's where you really see it.
Yep.
Yeah.
And again, on its surface, if I'm looking at the image on the screen of the IQ4, I do one with and one without, I'm never going to be able to see the difference.
And in all the highlight or brightly lit areas, you won't see a difference either, because they will all be from that first exposure.
Right.
Yeah.
So it is bringing up all those shadows. You're going to have all that flexibility.
Mm-hmm.
So this is just one tool that it's not finished yet, but it's been out for a while, and we're looking forward to your feedback. That is really a continuation of developing and building tools, features, functions that support image quality, image quality, and image quality on the Infinity platform found in the IQ4 that's available for these cameras, or anything else you want to lump that IQ4 onto, by all means, mm-hmm. please do. Dual Exposure Plus for use in some scenarios, automatic frame averaging for use in other scenarios. Each has its own distinct benefit, but of course they're always going to come back to improving image quality. That's it. Almost forgot.
In an easily usable way.
Well, that's our goal.
Yeah.
It's not always there, but you know, that's the end game. So please come to us with your feedback. If you have any questions suggestions, support.phase1.com. Our fantastic support team is going to be there to field all of your questions, pass on whatever they feel that they can't answer themselves to Lau and I, or if it's a fantastic, crazy idea, they're going to give it to us with a wry smile, and Lau and I are going to have a lot of fun with it. So please reach out to us, support.phase1.com. Any questions or concerns, reach out to your local Phase 1 partner. If you want to get your hands on one of these, there's a few here that we can send out, and a few elsewhere. Thank you for joining us. We hope you learned something, and it's been fantastic talking to all of you digitally. This mm-hmm. is the most social interaction I've had in a month, given the audience. I mean, you know, I haven't talked to 100 people at once in a long time. So thank you for joining us. We really do appreciate it. Everybody stay safe, stay smart, and Lau and I are going to be doing a whole bunch more of this. So we look forward to seeing you on the next one.
See you next time.
Thank you.